I'm going to spend a few minutes talking about lubricating a brass piper, but before I get into turning it over and showing you all the points on the underside that need lubrication, let's talk a little bit about what's on top of this locomotive. Of course, you see these beautiful brass pipes, and these are only unique to the brass piper series. But when you want to lubricate the engine, unfortunately, behind the pipes is a lubrication point on the armature. What I'm going to show you is what I've done to get that lubricated. And there's a similar point on the other side of the locomotive, but let's just do this one. There are three small screws on each side of the locomotive. And I'm going to just gently loosen them and let the brass pipes drop, as you see here. You don't want to loosen this one up here because it holds the valve gear. But I have a lubricant that I've used before. It's pet and child friendly, and it doesn't have odors. And I put a little bit of this in a plastic bottle so that I can negotiate it a little easier. But what I'm going to do is just give it a squirt right in there in that side. And so that will lubricate that side of the armature. And one other point I want to point out before I turn it over, and I'll show you after I put the brass pipes back up, is part of the reversing mechanism. But now I'm going to pause the video with a short break. The next thing that's worth noting on these is the brass piper, along with the triangular valve gear steam locomotives, have two levers in the back of the cab. And we're going to talk about these just for a couple of moments. The lever that's farthest in the middle of the cab, is the one that controls whether the automatic reverse is enabled or not. And the lever on the far right-hand side, the lower lever, is a lever which determines whether the motor will run forward or backward. And you'll see what happens when I work these two levers. So over here, this lever, as I said, controls whether the automatic reverse is enabled or not. And the lower lever basically determines in which direction. So I'm going to go back to photographing the side of the locomotive again and explain how this all works. I've moved back a little farther, so I hope you can see all the details. But in particular, one of the details to notice is the position of this rod right here. As I said before, that's the rod which determines the direction of travel. And right now we're in the manual mode, and I can take that rod and I can move it in or out. So I'll start with it out. The other thing that's worth taking notice of, if you can see it, is this feature right here, which is geared toward the motor mechanism. And this is a little mechanical device that's actuated by the power of the engine. And you'll kind of see what goes on when I take the next step. So at this point, the locomotive is set for manual reverse. And I can basically take the locomotive and move it freely. Okay. No problem at all. And you notice that that little piece in there is spinning around as the wheels spin. There's a couple cogs on it. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take the lever, which determines the direction of motion, and activate it. And I don't know whether you can see, but a little mechanical piece jumped into position. And what happens is, the next time the mechanical part comes around and contacts that positioner, it forces it to move. And if I move the locomotive back and forth, you can see the action here that my direction lever is moving back and forth as I move the locomotive. And that happens every time that the rod encounters the rotating piece that's coupled to the gear mechanism. So this is how the remote reverse actually operates. And what happens is when the motor regains power for a new direction, that little piece is lifted up by the magnetism in the motor and out of the way, and the locomotive will run in the new direction that's set. This is done by interrupting power. And this can be seen when the locomotive is put on the track. And in fact, I think I've done some demonstrations with this reversing. And this one reverses about as well as any of them. And one other point that's interesting, while I have the locomotive in this point, I'm going to set it so that I can just freewheel right now. On top of the locomotive, behind the steam dome, is this lever. And as you can hear that, that's what activates the bell. And of course you can hear it. It's a pretty good sounding bell. So pretty much that's our overview of things that can happen on top of the locomotive. So what I'm going to do next is to turn it upside down so we can get a good look at the wheels and gears that are underneath and need to be lubricated. This is the underside of our locomotive. And to make it a little easier to see what's going on with it, I'm going to take the trailing truck and just turn it out of the way, because you can see some features when I do that that are heretofore hidden. Primarily, all the reversing mechanism is back here. I don't have a firebox light in this right now because I don't have any more bulbs left, but it's capable of having one. It did. And I guess I stole it for something else. But here is the lever that determines whether the motor runs forward and reverse. And actually it basically just wires to a set of switches with some contacts. And over, I'm reaching now, and you can see this point move. This is the enabler for whether it automatically reverses or not. And I put some lubrication on all the pivot points there. In the front here is our ringing bell mechanism, and this is geared to the motor, and every couple revolutions the bell will ring, as you heard when I moved it. I've lubricated most of this already, but just to mention the points that do need lubrication, and I can move this truck out of the way right now. Every axle should be lubricated. All these gears should have lubrication. There's a point here which anchors to the frame of the engine, which should be lubricated. And of course, previously you saw me apply lubrication to the cups that are on either side of the armature. In addition, you want to put a little lubrication on the pilot and trailing wheels. And at that point, all should be good. You probably don't have to lubricate your valve gear if it's in good condition. And as you can see here in this one, everything should turn freely. So that's kind of the underside view of our Brass Piper locomotive. I hope it's been informative. You'll find in a lot of these, when you get them, if you have one that's been sitting in a barnyard for a long time, the reverser levers don't move, and basically you can free them up with some WD-40 or equivalent, and that's the way to get them moving and get the contacts working again, because usually they can be convinced to work, and once they do, they work reasonably well. Although basically when the engine reverses, it's abrupt, so it's best to bring the power down slowly and let the mechanism slowly move the lever so the engine doesn't jerk and pull the cars and yank the cars. And you'll find then things seem to go pretty well. So this engine will be all lubricated, and basically it's prepared for the test on the big track for the spring event. Thanks for watching. Have a great day.